Couple things I wanted to find out. First off, how many of you here were 4-H kids? Good bunch of you. Good. That's good to hear. So I was as well. And of course, in 4-H, public speaking was one of the most dreaded things, right? One of my leaders, though, told me that it's really good if you start your presentation with a joke. And so I'm going to do that tonight. But I'm going to do it probably a little different because I'm going to start with a joke so bad that my speech can really only get better from there, okay? So brace yourselves. A guy walks into a psychiatrist's office, and he's wearing his cowboy boots, nothing else but saran wrap, okay? And the psychiatrist looks at him and said, "I can clearly see you're nuts." Okay, good. So I'm one of the things that I'm always interested in is what makes people tick, what they're passionate about. I'm passionate about 4 or 5 things in my life, and tonight I'm going to try and keep things interesting. I'm going to speak about at least 3 of them, okay? Beef production, I live and breathe. That's one of my things that I am very passionate about. Technology is something that I've been interested in from a very young age. Fly fishing is something that, as John mentioned, I do whenever I get the opportunity. So if I do my job right here, we'll see if we can weave all those things into a bit of a story tonight. So for a disclaimer here, right, my topic, I guess, if I go back, was the future of technology in the cattle industry. Well, I can't tell the future any more than you people can, right? So this disclaimer here says, you know, don't hold me accountable if anything I say tonight doesn't turn out to be the absolute gospel truth, and you lose a lot of money because you invested in some of the ideas that we're talking about here. So I'm going to give you a little background about Feedlot Health, just so that you kind of can understand my world a little bit. So Feedlot Health was started in 1983 by Dr. Key Jim, and at that point in 83, it was a new concept for animal health management programs, different than anything else really that anyone had seen before, based in South Central Alberta. And since 83 then, it's sort of evolved to include production consulting across a wide range of the beef production chain. And we service commercial feedlot and calf growers as well. So we're based in Okotoks, is where we call home. We currently provide services to feedlots and calf growers that put through about 3 million head of cattle a year. So we have about a pretty good customer base. I have about 3 million clients a year. So that sort of puts a bit of context around the volumes we're talking about. Our mission is to provide world-class consulting and research services along with management and execution tools to really the bottom line. Our reason for being is to improve the profitability of our customers. So that comes a number of different ways, but really that's what it really all boils down to, is to improve profitability of beef production. Currently, these are our customers, right? So we've got up in the northern parts of Alberta, over to British Columbia, Ontario, Quebec, as far south as Vera Cruz. On the other side of the globe, we've got a couple of lines in the water, but nothing that's very concrete at this point. A couple of people have asked me throughout the day today, how many people I work with. So I think the number here of, as far as professionals, and that means veterinarians, nutritionists, epidemiologists, statisticians, engineers, those types of, you know, highly educated people that we can rely on to be experts in areas within the beef production chain. That number, I think, is already out of date. because we hired another nutritionist on Friday. But so 30 professionals. There's about 40 additional staff members that keep the rest of us going by supporting us. So we're close to about 70 people in the office there. This is the reason I really enjoy coming to work. These people are young, vibrant, intelligent. It's a pleasure for me to come to work every day. So this is part of the reason that Feedlot Health has been a success. So enough about the corporate background. Thought I'd tell you a little bit about my personal background, right? So I grew up in Lloydminster, just outside of Lloydminster, on a cow-calf operation, a couple hundred head of commercial cows. I tell people, though, that our farm was 12 miles into the Saskatchewan side. So that means that I speak both Alberta and Saskatchewan, so I can actually kind of relate to both. But my roots originally were in Saskatchewan. Went to school in Saskatoon and have since become employed in Alberta. But that's my background. This picture here, that's my dad. This was a pretty good day for him. You know, he was pretty happy. He's got his dog there. He's got his horse. That saddle is actually the saddle that my great-grandfather rode when he came from Oklahoma to Midnight Lake, Saskatchewan, to homestead there. And so that's been passed down through the generations. Currently, it's on a stand in my office. But the reason I bring this picture up is because my dad wasn't necessarily huge into technology, right? All of these things that made him happy here were living and breathing things, not things that turned on with electricity. But he did appreciate the value of data. Even back in the day, we would be raising bulls to sell to commercial cattlemen, and he would spend a lot of time writing out tabular show lists, and each animal or each bull, prospective bull for sale, had its tag number and its mother's tag number and its sire and its birth weight and its weight per day of age and its 365 day adjusted average daily gain, everything lined out there, and then the price over at the right-hand side, so that we, you know, would go out and look at bulls with customers, and then they'd come around and drink coffee at the table, and this list was actually how they would make their decisions on which bull they wanted to purchase. So that's kind of a little bit about my background, but part of what, you know, why I am the way I am today is I grew up during a time when these two beasts here just sort of came out of the closet. So on the left-hand side, we've got the IBM PC XT, right? The first real mainstream sort of computer that was used in, that was available for purchase, right, for personal use. On the right side here, we've got the Apple II Plus. And so when I was growing up, my junior high school had one of these, right? And I used to actually stay after hours at school. You won't find too many kids that voluntarily stay later at school, but I used to, because that's when the computer was open, when it wasn't actually tied up. And so, you know, I worked with a couple of the teachers there to get a little extra time on there. It was something I found very interesting. And later on in high school, I actually formed what I think is probably the first 4-H computer club, actually, that got put together. And again, it was just so that I could get access to, selfishly, to the computers for learning, right? I was just curious. I wanted to know more about them. So it's an interesting blend, but I've been really lucky because I like cattle and I like computers. And as you probably saw a little bit about the company that I work with, we've managed to meld those two together, and it works pretty well. There's another one of my passions. This is a trip down the Bow River, and a beautiful little rainbow trout here that I caught that day. I'm going to throw a slide in there just to make me stop and catch my breath, all right, and change gears a little bit. So one of the things, when we talk about different technologies, one of the things that I think might actually have some, not, you know, in the long distant future, but actually closer future, applications is these autonomous self-riding, self-flying vehicles, the drones. This is one that Feedlot Health purchased a little while. It's a Phantom 3 DJI Pro. Basically, it's a quadricopter. Before Feedlot Health bought one of these, I actually owned one personally. It was probably 7 or 8 years ago, one of the first ones that came out, just because it was kind of cool and I really needed to experience it. So there's an image of the drone sort of flying down Feedlot Alley here. So what are you going to use a drone for? What could you use a drone for? And here's some ideas. You can kind of see, you know, you can probably assess pen conditions. We saw some of the talks from Greg earlier today about what the conditions in the pen can mean as far as performance. Well, these drones actually can go and document this. I'll show you some images later where you can quantify that, I believe. And then if you can quantify that, then you can actually relate it to the subsequent performance. That's one thing. Another thing is pen riding, potentially, and I put riding in quotation marks there. But I'll show you some examples of that in a little bit here. Cattle handling, it's conceptual. Maybe give you some examples. Bunk scoring, I think, is actually a very real possibility. And I think you guys can, in some videos that I'll show up here in a little bit, you'll be able to see that. Another simple example, someone raised the concern over worker safety at some point today. And worker safety is a concern for sure. There's places you can send a drone and get very good images that you should never send a person, or that you might not want to send a person. And we've got one example that I can show you just where, you know, sending the drone up to the top of a mill, we were able to actually see some things that we didn't have to send Joe up there or whoever, right? So chronological assessment of pen conditions, it might be a little bit hard to see from the back, but basically what we're showing here is that here's a given pen and then several sequential days, and you can actually measure some of the differences in the spots of moisture. You can look at cattle crowding and document those things over time. I think that's going to be a pretty simple thing to do if someone wanted. As far as pen riding goes, this is Dr. Eric Belke. He's one of those guys that was on the list of people that work with Feedlot Health that I really enjoy going to work with every day. And here he's sitting on the fence with the drone controls, controlling it and working it through the pens of cattle. And so if we get this working, there's some video footage here. So he's sitting on the bunk rail, and this is the point of view from the drone, right? It's a pretty good quality image, and he can be controlling that from, in this example, he's only about 60 yards away, but he can be controlling it from up to 2 kilometers away if need be. I find it interesting to see how the animals are reacting to the drone. That was one of the questions is, you know, do they get very scared by it, or are they relatively unfazed by it? And while it did get their attention, they didn't really seem to be bothered by it very much. So in that example, he was just sort of running through the cattle. This one here, I hope, someone's going to stand up and say, there's the sick one, because by the time this is over, if you can't identify the sick animal, I think that we could, you know, can you spot him yet? Yeah. So in this example, though, we'll drive the drone right up so close you can read his tag number here. Yeah, he can see that right on his on the screen. Yeah. Yeah. So finally, he was about 2 feet away from him, hovering off his back end before he left and got off the water.
You should have tried that a couple of days ago.
Yeah, yeah. All right. On the subject of bunk scoring, okay, so that's one of the things that people spend a fair bit of time doing is driving along and reviewing how much feed is left over and judging, the condition of the bunk. And if you look at this drone, we set it to go at 2 meters per second at a height of 2 meters above the bunk. And this is actually pretty easy to see. You can see quite nicely how much feed is left in the bunk, what the conditions are, how many cattle are up there. Now, you don't have to be sitting on the fence doing this. You can actually be sitting at your office doing this, right? And the next one I think is even cooler because, so we took, this is a 6,000 head feed yard just outside of High River. And we actually just mapped all of those bunks, okay? Pre-programmed that into the drone and said, fly this course, right? So, if any of you are seasick or get motion sickness here, you may want to avert your eyes for this one, but we've sped this up a little bit. But basically, in this video, whoop, I lost it. In this video, this is sort of a time lapse, but you can see on each of these pens, it's pretty easy to tell how much feed is left in there. The drone covered the entire yard in about 18 minutes, and no one had to tell it where to go or anything. It just followed the path, and after that, you could actually sit there and you could, you know, review the video and say, oh, pen 6 was a score 2, and pen 7 was a score 1, and away you go. And no one was flying the drone at that point. I find that part kind of interesting. Here's the part, get my mouse going. Here's the part where, I guess I could probably give kudos to anyone who finds the actual spot, but there is a spot on this video where there's a safety violation, and it's actually spotted with the drone. You'll get an idea here, but The in this case, we were just sort of playing around. The feed yard owner was watching over this as we were sort of flying the drone up the leg of the mill, and he just said, stop, right? Stop right there. We've actually got to go and, you know, send someone up there to fix this. And I'll point it out to you here. See those exposed belts right there? Okay, those drive belts should have a shroud on them, right? So yeah, that's actually that was one of the safety violations, and they picked that up just by playing around, trying to see what they could do with this drone. So I think in this example, you can easily set it to go and, you know, go up there and collect the images. Without anyone taking any damage. If it does happen to crash or fall down, you're not out any human life. It's just a matter of equipment. Cattle inventory counts, of course, you know, with the drone and a 4K image, you get very good resolution. And so you can actually do images like this, and you can count cattle pretty easily. I think the banks are already doing this. Where I think we're going to see a fair bit of change happening is in automating this, because I think right now there's probably student interns that actually literally look at these pictures and count cattle. I think we're going to be able to train computers to do that pretty quickly, but I also think that there's probably a little bit more to it than people guess. Because shadows can play into there, a black animal versus a shadow can look pretty similar. But I don't think it's too long before that's going to be happening automatically. So what I talked about so far was feedlot applications of these drones, right? I think a lot of you here also have pasture operations, and I think we can think of at least one or two examples where they might be useful. So Dr. Belke, he was out at a spot, and one of the things that he was trying to see is there a use for this in this area? And the place where he was, he said, it was a pretty intensive grazing operation. They would actually, they had hot wire fences that they would move every so often so that the cattle would get exposed to new grass. And they used to spend a fair bit of time driving quads out to the site, and they would want to make sure that there was water present for the animals and check the cattle, check their salt and mineral, and check the grazing pressure so that they would know whether they needed to move the wire so that the cattle could get onto some fresh grass. And so Eric said, I think I could probably do most of those things just, you know, from here in the office with the drone, right? So they had a little race. Of course, Eric, if any of you know him, he's a little competitive, right? So they had a race, and he actually ended up, I'll give you a should run this while it's going, but this has been sped up, but you can see here, probably right off the bat, we can actually view the condition of the water. Again, from the office, not having to go out to the pasture, we can see the condition of the salt and actually start to see the condition of the residual grass here as well. At one point, he even drops the drone right down into it so he could measure the height of it. And then he turned around and flew the drone back home. And about the time that he was coming back home, the guy on the quad was just getting to the pasture to open the gate. And so that all happened without him having to actually leave. Now, I'm not sure that that's applicable in everyone's scenario, but I do think that if we can get these things so that they have a decent battery life and you can pre-program them, then a lot of this stuff, you can probably send four or five of them out at once and collect images and either watch them live as they're live streaming them back or gather the images afterwards and review them. Okay, there's another one of my friends from the Bow River. Interesting fact, I guess, is that 24 hours after this picture was taken, we had about 8 inches of heavy, wet snow that pretty much broke more than half of the trees in Calgary because everything was still green. There was all the trees still had all their leaves on them, and we got a huge snowstorm that night. So any questions about drones? Yeah, go ahead.
Have you run into issues with airspace and permits? Because I know we tried to fly one to do fields and they're too close to the airport.
Yeah, I very specifically avoided talking about that because that's a good question though. I'm glad you brought it up. It's variable, right? So what the rules were 6 months ago are actually not what they are today. And it's also variable in various different zones, right? So you should, if you're considering doing that, you should check with your local authorities as well as there's a Canadian organization, and I don't have the name off the tip of my tongue, but it has to do with to be the equivalent of the FAA in the U.S., the Federal Aviation Authority. That actually has some guidelines on that. If you're interested, I could probably dig them up and send them to you, but you do want to double check. The other part is that there's differences if you're going to use them for personal use versus commercial use or business use. If you want to make a business of this, then there's a bunch more regulations that you've got to go through as well.
Okay. How
much are they? That one is about $1,700. It's come down from then, actually. Not that expensive, really, in the big scheme of things. Yeah.
How long would it take somebody who's inexperienced to learn how to fly it?
How old is the person who's inexperienced?
50?
Not too much. Not too long. Probably about 20 minutes. The reason these things have gotten as popular as they are, they actually are flying microcomputers with multiple sensors in them. They have sensors that'll tell if they're too close to the ground, and they won't let you crash. They have sensors that'll tell if they're moving too far in one direction or another. So they're actually really hard to crash. Now, I've done it, but the other thing is that if the reason I asked about the age question is that if it's a younger generation person, especially if they've ever played any video games, they won't even think twice about it. They would have that drone, you know, flying around this room inside here, doing laps around the posts and, you know, anything without any concerns whatsoever. That's one of the things that is improving. They have about 25 minutes on a battery. And I'm putting it in terms of minutes because it's actually more relevant. It depends on how you fly. If you're gonna fly high and get an overhead view, then you use up some of your minutes getting up there. If you're gonna fly a long distance, then you're gonna, you know, go at a high speed. But generally speaking, you got about 25 minutes. Cold weather, we haven't actually had any issues with temperature specifically. Wind is a bugger, right? I think we ran some numbers and looked at the number of flyable days out of High River, and it was about 87%. So the converse of that would be about 13% of the days actually weren't suitable for flying. Yeah. Cool. Yep. An order form. Yeah, there you go. Okay, just go online, you'll find one. Okay, so the next thing I was going to bring up here, first off, I've got a typo up at the top here. I've got 100 years there. Apparently, mathematics isn't one of my strengths. If you can read this, this is a 1907 car, and that's not 100 years, that's 110 years, right? So I'll correct that. But I picked up this picture here yesterday, as a matter of fact. I got into town a little bit earlier here than I needed to, so I went down just north and east of us here to the Western Development Museum. Interesting. If you've never been there, it's worth the $10 to tour around. I'm interested in history. This is a 1907 Russell touring car, and actually it was owned by a fellow here from Moose Jaw. Russell is the last name of the president of the Canadian Cycle and Motor Works, CCM. Okay. CCM's known for bicycles. I wore a pair of skates when I was playing hockey that were CCMs. I did not know that they built cars. I found that quite interesting. So, but in 110 years, we've gone from something that looks like that to something that looks like this. I don't know how many of you have followed the newest advancements in cars, but this brand here, I think, is gonna change the auto industry a lot. It's called Tesla. This particular car broke a record here recently. It goes from 0 to 60 in 2.28 seconds. This car, I don't think, could go 60. I think if you did 0 to 60, you'd measure it in tanks of gas. Actually, if you wanted, you could drop this thing off a cliff and let gravity take it down. This would still beat it. This actually accelerates faster than the rate of gravity. Blows my mind. Anyways, part of what I was meaning here is in 110 years, they're still cars, right? They have four wheels. When you want to change the direction, the two front wheels pivot on their axis. And when you want to change the direction of those two front wheels, you grab a round steering wheel and you crank it, right? There's really, there's been some change in 110 years, but there hasn't been that much change. I think there's more on the future. But how about this guy? That was 10 years ago, almost to the day. Like, 10 years ago, the Apple IIG was announced. And this has changed our world as much as almost anything I can think of. And so what has this got to do with the future of technology in the cattle industry? Well, 10 years after, we've got 1.9 billion smartphone users on this planet. All of the goodies that Steve Jobs built into that iPhone 2G and every subsequent phone and smartphone that's come along afterwards, are a lot of them are sensors, right? And so these proximity sensors, accelerometers, gyroscopes, GPS, wireless communication modules, there's lots of them. Lots of goodies built into that phone. They're all mass produced now. They're smaller and they're cheaper. So suddenly now, a GPS module that used to cost $40 is probably now, if they're mass produced, they might be $6, might be $3. So these sensors are going to change things a lot, I think. What are you going to use sensors for, right? So I think things like animal localization, so knowing where an animal is at any given point in time, I think is pretty important. We know you can monitor temperature. I think we're still going to struggle to find practical ways of doing that. We've seen rumen pH reported here this morning, and we never got into the gory details of it, but I'll bet you they used remote sensors. I bet they didn't actually stick pH meters into the animals. I think it was a remote device that they were using to do it. Pedometers to measure animal movement. I think all of these things have the potential to do some pretty big industry shifting changes in how we use technology to our advantage. So I'm going to talk about eating behavior here. I want you to pay attention to the left ear on this animal. So notice the difference between this animal here and how that ear is pumping up and down, cycling nice and rhythmically, compared to any of his mates there, like this one here, that's just standing there, right? They're both in the same location, but one is actively eating and one's not. So with the right sensors, we can actually tell. Even though they're both those two animals are standing in the exact same location. So I think what we're going to see is ear tags with these sensors built into them. Okay, and these are two examples that I am familiar with. There's probably more getting out there every day. But I've worked with both of these two, and I'll share some of the experiences that I've had. So this is what the ear tag looks like. And a tagger and a back to put it in to the animal's ear. If the ear tag is going to send out a signal, somewhere, somehow, someone has got to listen and receive that signal, right? So this is an example that we recently put up this fall in one of our yards. And this is a solar panel. There's a 12-volt battery inside here. There's a reader here that's listening for those ear tag signals, and then there's another reader here that's going to boomerang that up to a big server. Part of why we need a big server is that there's a lot of data, right? If we're going to read the information from these tags every 4 seconds, and we've got 1,200 animals in there in a reading area, you can imagine that data piles up pretty quickly. So with a combination, this is just a survey tripod here. We put up those readers and surveyed them and mapped them so that we've got everything mapped down to the inches. And then when a tag sends out a signal and it's read by at least 3 different readers, well, we can triangulate that animal's position. Okay, and then we can know where it is. So if we know where that animal is and we know where this animal is, we also know where this animal is, and these two animals here might be that they're buddies. I don't know if you guys have noticed this in going through pens of cattle, but quite often there's social groups of animals that stick together. And one of the things that I believe is that by collecting this information, we can actually make use of some of the social behavior of the animals to tell us how they're doing. So this video here is one particular animal, and this is the pen. This is the feed bunk down here. These times, you probably can't see them from the back. This is 12 o'clock midnight. Here we're at 4 a.m., and look at that. He got up and had a bite to eat and then went back and laid down. Comes across to about 8 o'clock a.m., and he's getting up and going to the feed bunk again, and then he goes back and lays down. He's got his own place he likes to lay down. And as we speed things up a little bit more, you can see how much he's traveled in a given day. Okay, this is just for one animal, for one 24-hour period. Okay, but we can tell then how many minutes he spent at the feed bunk, how many minutes he spent at the water bowl, how many minutes he spent with his social colleagues that he likes to hang with. Yes?
He forgot to check if the gate's open.
He went back here and checked the back gate to see if it was open. He didn't get out. Where did the question come from? Yeah. Can you see that blue dot right underneath my red or green laser pointer? No. Okay. Water bowl's right here, 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 and in this pen it's right there. Okay.
Do you notice that as a pattern with if you check another individual? Is there like he's more to the left side of that pen?
Absolutely. They have their favorite places, yeah. And you've probably noticed this.
Are there random animals that will be all
over? Yeah, so there's variability, right? So each animal has its own normal and its own variability. And so I can't give you the specifics on any one given animal, but they all have their own, just no different than us. Each of us, when we went to the buffet, probably had, you know, our own preference of how much salad we took and how much beef we took and everything else. And if we studied that at the same buffet for a couple of weeks, we could probably start to do pattern recognition and saying, well, here comes Miles. Miles always skips all of the green stuff, right? And he goes right to the end and takes a great big load of beef. Well, you know, that we in a group like this, we'd probably get hard to recognize that because I'm sure there's lots of carnivores in the group, but the idea is that pattern recognition can be done with large data sets by computers. So in this particular animal here, that was just one example. Another thing you can do, so in this image we've got, at that point I think we have 160, 170 animals in this pen. But if we wanted to locate one, and I think you may not be able to see it, but I'm going to type something in up in the filter field there. You can click on any one of these, and it'll tell you what their tag number is. But if we wanted to find I-346, you start typing that in, and oh, there he is, right? He's at the back pen by the gate there. And so if you needed to locate him, that's where you get him. Yes.
Earlier in the slide, with the cow, with the feeder animal's head bobbing, will that identify that as well? Not necessarily just where he's at the pen, but as much as how many times his head is bobbing at that feed bunk?
Yeah, so there's a number of different things you can do. And you know, if you ask me what this system can do, probably doesn't matter because this system isn't going to be the system that we're going to use a year from now or 3 years from now, right? So I wouldn't get too hung up on the specifics, but yes, this system actually has an algorithm that detects rumination as well as eating.
So will it also detect his body temperature?
This one doesn't, yeah. And there are other ones that are out there, and I am yet to see the value of body temperature of an ear. In fact, the correlation goes the opposite direction that you'd expect. And I don't know, so think about that for a little bit. If an animal is sick and its core temperature gets elevated, It does that quite often by restricting, vasorestricting the extremities. And so on an ear or some of those places, you sometimes get a lower temperature. Yeah. So, but temperature is an option for sure. If we found a good way of measuring it, that could be one of the sensors that you build into your ear tag. Yeah. So here's another slightly different system. Same kind of an idea. And in this system, so you see a bunch of blue dots on there, and if you look close, we'll zoom in. There's one that's shaded red in the upper corner there. The reason it's shaded red is that we've identified it as being abnormal. And so if we collect all the information on the animal every 5 seconds, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, within about 72 hours, we can determine what normal is for each of the 300 animals in a pen. And then once we know what normal is for that animal, then when he's abnormal, that's an indication that he probably has. In this case, we're predicting BRD, okay, respiratory disease. One of the challenges I think that our industry faces is having skilled labor that can actually accurately identify sick cattle. And I think technology is going to be able to assist us with that. So I'll give you an example here where, in this case, so we'll zoom in on this a little bit. And if you follow this red dot up in the corner here, I'll scroll down and you'll be able to see that this particular animal was identified as being on the pull list. I think it's I-344. And the pull list comes up due to, like I said before, abnormal behavior in social interactions, feeding behavior, exercising behavior. And the red guy up in the corner there is the one that we're going to have to pull. And so before ever going into the pen, you can pull up your smartphone, dial it in and say, oh yeah, he's in the southwest corner. It's going to be easy. He's I-344, and I know where I'm going to find him. And then this is the part that I found even more interesting, is that, I don't think that played. So if you take a look at this animal's ear here, we've actually got that tag with an LED light that's flashing. So not only can we look at him on our smartphone and say he's in the southwest corner of the pen, but he's the one with the blinking light in his ear. Okay, and I think we may not need skilled people to locate these cattle if we can get it to the point where we can accurately detect them. Now, I don't know if we're, 100% of the way there yet, but I do believe that, sorry, you had a question?
Yeah.
Yeah. 3 days, 72 hours. We can start, the algorithms will start to be sensitive after 36 hours, but I'm always a little leery about that because I think it takes a baseline of at least 48 to 72 hours of building what normal is. And what makes this system pretty unique is that normal is it's not an average, right? It's normal for that individual animal, right? We've tracked enough of his individual information that we know what his normal is. And so when he goes off his normal, that's when he's off feed or he's off of his feeling good. Well, so this is an experimental system, right? The ear tags, it's gonna depend. It's like when 10 years ago, when the smartphones first came out, they were pretty expensive. These, and when things got mass produced, they actually were able to be less expensive, each individual component. But those ear tags individually are going to be in the neighborhood of about $50 to $60 right now. You can reuse them, yeah.
20 years?
You probably could. They got removable batteries, so you just yank them out, throw another battery in there, and away you go, yeah.
Do you recollect the tags at harvest or at
loading? Yeah. We recollect them at before harvest, before they leave the feed yard. So in this sense, since what we're looking for is primarily respiratory disease, we usually need them in the animal's ears for that first 40 days or so. If they come through for a re-implant at day 70 or day 100, we'll cut them out, repurpose them, and put them in the next batch. What's the range on the tags? So they are an RID, radio frequency tag? Yeah, they are, but they're not on the same frequency as the readers that we've got in the back there. Those readers in the back are low frequency readers. They read at 134.2 kilohertz, right? The good thing about low frequency readers is they'll read through bone, they'll read through flesh, they'll read through water, but they don't read very far. These tags are in the 2.4 gigahertz spectrum, and they'll read, it isn't so much how far the tags will read, it's the periphery of those readers that we need in order to triangulate accurately. And so we need a reader about every 80 meters is what it boils down to. So for right now, 4. Time, animal's identification, X and Y coordinates. From that, we can back our way into a lot of different things. Yeah. And there's a lot more that can be done once we get additional sensors like gyrometers and accelerometers. I think the sky is the limit, really. I'm not sure if I understand the question. Could you rephrase it? Yeah.
Have you looked into the programs that are coming out now with facial recognition?
Yep.
And using that as tracking on the cattle side of it?
No, not that I'm aware of. We've looked at image recognition software, not in terms of identifying animals, but selfishly in terms of pattern recognition on post-mortem images, right? So I think there's actually a fair bit to be gained there by, if we take a standard set of post-mortem images, I think we can train computers to make diagnoses on post-mortem images probably 80 to 85% accurate, given the right inputs, yeah. But that's not what you're asking. You're asking about facial recognition specifically? No. Yes? yeah, that's right. I didn't put any of Eric's footage up there, but he actually did empty a pen on purpose with some help. But he opened the gate at the back and then used the drone to sort of haze the cattle back towards the back of the pen, and they all left. There was one additional person that was in there with him, but the drone actually did the majority of the work. I don't think it's that much different than a stock dog, really. But so any other thoughts or questions on the, yeah, go ahead.
So when you're assessing the normal, if an animal comes to the pen sick already, then the normal would be a sick animal.
Correct.
So
it's a self-correcting algorithm in that if you for a given date, you're going to look at the normal behavior for the recent events, and you're going to look at the magnitude. And so in the case of a sick animal, he's actually going to appear to be getting better as opposed to getting worse. So what's important is the change, right? From one to another, and in the case of a sick to a healthier animal, then that's actually nothing that we're that concerned about. There's a change that we recognize, but it's in the right direction. There's lots to be worked through, though. I mean, that's a really good question. By the time you take, you know, a variety of animals from a variety of sources, a variety of histories, they've all got different eating exposures. Some of them are bunk broke, some of them aren't. You might fill the pen over 10 days. You know, there's lots of different things to consider. But I have a lot of hope that given enough data, that we can probably solve those problems. So, yeah. So, a couple other thoughts, and I, you know, I could go on for a little while, but a couple other things that I thought I'd mention, mostly on the subject of potential future things that aren't specific to cattle. One of them, I think, is shoot side diagnostics. I believe, so we've made a lot of advancement in diagnostic tests recently over the past 10 years. And I actually can see a day when you will be able to take a sample from your animal and add a couple of drops from this bottle and a couple of drops from that bottle, shake it, set it on your counter beside your chute, line up your iPhone or your smartphone above it and use the image processor in it and the processing power in it to read the amount of item X in that sample. Now I'm not going to, I don't even know what that might be. It could be haptoglobin to look for inflammation. It could be a genetic test to look, you know, I don't know, but I do believe that those tests are actually not that far around the corner. And I think they will actually have a pretty big impact on the production of beef, because it will allow us to do some things that currently we don't have very good tests for. A good example of that is the tuberculosis debacle that just recently happened, right? I mean, part of the reason that we've had to struggle through so many animals is that there actually isn't a good test for that. If we had a better test, I think we'd have a better outcome for it. So, but that's a political aside. Another example I can think of just off the top of my head is if I go back to that red car that I showed down there, the Tesla, that car comes pre-equipped with 8 cameras and a radar system built into it. It's fully loaded and ready for complete autonomous driving. There won't be a human needed to drive that car. And I think your feed trucks are going to get there eventually, right? It's only a matter of time before you won't have to have a human to deliver the feed to the pen of cattle. It'll just be a series of drone trucks that'll do it for you. Yeah.
Except the human will have to wash it every day.
Fair enough. And blow off the dash because it'll still be dusty. Yeah. No.
Oh.
No.
Or no. You shouldn't be.
We're in the process of validating the concept, right? I don't want to get in the business of marketing the tag, right? I don't want to be a tag manufacturer. Like anything else, I want to use information to the advantage of my customers. Whether it comes from that tag or a different tag or whatever, it doesn't really matter. Okay, this one will be, this is more of a laugh for you guys than anything else, but some of you might find it interesting. You'll have to read along with it. Let me know if you can't read it, because it has a joke built into it. No? There we go. So this is from Australia, and this is basically a quad that's been, instead of a quadricopter like we were using, this is one. This one's ground-based, but it's the same sort of thing. Glad you guys got the joke. Yeah. So similar sort of an idea, except it's ground-based instead of air-based with the drones. And these guys are actually making, I think, in Australia, they're making some pretty good headway. Not sure how applicable or practical it would be, but their vision is, again, you know, sensors, right? They see that in this scenario, sensors, they're actually going to be able to measure the residual crop that's available, so they know when it's time to open the gate and put the, in this case, sheep over onto another pasture. And how many of you here have experience in dairy? Robots have changed the dairy industry, right? Will continue to do so. So, you know, that's another example of something that I think may be on the horizon. And that's pretty much about all I had. I was going to leave you with this one quote here, because I'm a scientist at heart, right? And I get a little bit frustrated sometimes when people make decisions, make policy, sometimes bureaucratic policy, based on emotion instead of science. But Carl Sagan said this like 30 years ago, a long time ago, and society is dependent on science and technology, right? Like it or not. But hardly anyone actually knows anything about that science and technology. And that's why I think, you know, any of you here, I would encourage you, don't be afraid of tech, right? When we have people that, you know, we're going to try and train them to use a computer system, some people are actually deathly afraid of technology. I would just encourage you, don't be afraid of it. Embrace it. Play with it. You know, enjoy it. Try to understand it, because I think in the it is our future, right? Like it or not. So. Cool. Any other questions?